Good evening. I'm Joseph Dobrian. Tonight and the next show also, I'm going to be reading some fiction. And it's some of my favorite stories, just to give you an idea of what I think makes good fiction. And then if there's time at the end of the story, I can talk about it a little bit. This first story that I'm going to read is by Phillip Roth, who is best known for his novels, but he also wrote short stories too. He was a very prolific author, best known in the 1960s and 70s. And this is a short story called The Conversion of the Jews. "You're a real one for opening your mouth in the first place," Itzy said. "What do you open your mouth all the time for?" "I didn't bring it up, Itz, I didn't," Ozzy said. "What do you care about Jesus Christ for, anyway?" "I didn't bring up Jesus Christ, he did. I didn't even know what he was talking about." "Jesus is historical," he kept saying. "Jesus is historical." Ozzy mimicked the monumental voice of Rabbi Binder. "Jesus was a person that lived just like you and me," Ozzy continued. "That's what Binder said." "Yeah, so what? And what do I give 2 cents whether he lived or not? And what do you got to open your mouth?" Itzy Lieberman favored closed-mouthedness, especially when it came to Ozzy Friedman's questions. Mrs. Friedman had had to see Rabbi Binder twice before about Ozzy's questions, and this Wednesday at 4:30 would be the third time. Itzy preferred to keep his mother in the kitchen. He settled for behind-the-back subtleties such as gestures, faces, snarls, and other less delicate barnyard noises. "He was a real person, Jesus, but he wasn't like God, and we don't believe he is God." Slowly, Ozzy was explaining Rabbi Binder's position to Itzy, who had been absent from Hebrew school the previous afternoon. "The Catholics," Itzy said helpfully, "they believe in Jesus Christ, that he's God." Itzy Lieberman used "the Catholics" in its broadest sense to include the Protestants. Ozzy received Itzy's remark with a tiny head bob as though it were a footnote and went on, "His mother was Mary, and his father probably was Joseph," Ozzy said, "but the New Testament says his real father was God." "His real father?" "Yeah," Ozzy said, "that's the big thing. His father is supposed to be God." "Bull." "Well, that's what Rabbi Binder says, that it's impossible." "Well, sure it's impossible. That stuff's all bull. To have a baby, you got to get laid." "Mary had to get laid." "Well, that's what Binder said. The only way a woman can have a baby is to have intercourse with a man."
"He said that, Oz? He said that, intercourse?"
"Oh, what did you guys do, Oz? You laugh or something?"
"Well, I raised my hand."
"Yeah, what'd you say?"
"Well, that's when I asked the question."
"What'd you ask about intercourse?"
No, I asked the question about God. How, if he could create the heaven and the earth in 6 days and make all the animals and the fish and the light in 6 days, the light especially, that's what always gets me, he could make the light. Making fish and animals, that's pretty good."
"Well, that's damn good."
"Well, yeah, but making light, I mean, when you think about it, it's really something. Anyway, I asked Binder if he could make all that in 6 days, and if he could pick the six days he wanted right out of nowhere, why couldn't he let a woman have a baby without having intercourse?"
"You said intercourse too, Oz? To Binder?"
"Yeah."
"Right in class?"
"Yeah."
I mean, no kidding around, that would really be nothing. After all the other stuff, that'd practically be nothing."
"What did Binder say?"
"Well, he started all over again explaining how Jesus was historical and how he lived like you and me, but he wasn't God. So I said I understood that. What I wanted to know was different."
What Ozzy wanted to know was always different. The first time he had wanted to know how Rabbi Binder could call the Jews the chosen people if the Declaration of Independence claimed all men to be equal. Rabbi Binder tried to distinguish for him between political equality and spiritual legitimacy, but what Ozzy wanted to know, he insisted vehemently, was different. That was the first time his mother had had to come. Then there was the plane crash. 58 people had been killed in a plane crash at LaGuardia. In studying a casualty list in the newspaper, his mother had discovered among the list of the dead 8 Jewish names. His grandmother had 9, but she counted Miller as a Jewish name. Because of the 8, she said the plane crash was a tragedy.
Well, now, during free discussion time on Wednesday, Ozzy had brought to Rabbi Binder's attention this matter of some of his relations always picking out the Jewish names. Rabbi Binder had begun to explain cultural unity and some other things when Ozzy stood up at his seat and said that what he wanted to know was different. Rabbi Binder insisted that he sit down, and it was then that Ozzy shouted that he wished all 58 were Jews. That was the second time his mother came. And he kept explaining about Jesus being historical, and so I kept asking him. No kidding, he was trying to make me look stupid. So what did he finally do? Well, finally he started screaming that I was deliberately simple-minded and a wise guy, and that my mother had to come, and this was the last time, and that I'd never get bar mitzvah if he could help it. Then he starts talking in that voice like a statue, real slow and deep, and he says, I better think over what I said about the Lord. He told me to go to his office and think it over. I thought it over for a solid hour, and now I'm convinced God could do it. Ozzy had planned to confess his latest transgression to his mother as soon as she came home from work, but it was a Friday night in November and already dark, and when Mrs. Friedman came through the door, she tossed off her coat, kissed Ozzy quickly on the face, and went to the kitchen table to light the three yellow candles, two for the Sabbath and one for Ozzy's father. When his mother lit the candles, she would move her two arms slowly towards her, dragging them through the air as though persuading people whose minds were half made up, and her eyes would get glassy with tears. Even when his father was alive, Ozzy remembered that her eyes had gotten glassy, so it didn't have anything to do with his dying. It had something to do with lighting the candles. As she touched the flaming match to the unlit wick of a Sabbath candle, the phone rang, and Ozzy, standing only a foot from it, plucked it off the receiver and held it muffled to his chest. When his mother lit candles, Ozzy felt that there should be no noise, even breathing if you could manage it. Ozzy pressed the phone to his breast and watched his mother dragging whatever she was dragging, and he felt his own eyes get glassy. His mother was a round, tired, gray-haired penguin of a woman whose gray skin had begun to feel the tug of gravity and the weight of her own history. Even when she was dressed up, she didn't look like a chosen person. But when she lit candles, she looked like something better, like a woman who knew momentarily that God could do anything. After a few mysterious minutes, she was finished. Ozzy hung up the phone and walked to the kitchen table where she was beginning to lay the two places for the four-course Sabbath meal. He told her that she would have to see Rabbi Binder next Wednesday at 4:30, and then he told her why. For the first time in their life together, she hit Ozzy across the face with her hand. All through the chopped liver and chicken soup part of the dinner, Ozzy cried. He didn't have any appetite for the rest. On Wednesday, in the largest of the three basement classrooms of the synagogue, Rabbi Marvin Binder, a tall, handsome, broad-shouldered man of 30 with thick, strong-fibered black hair, removed his watch from his pocket and saw that it was 4:00. At the rear of the room, Yaakov Blotnik, the 71-year-old custodian, slowly polished the large window, mumbling to himself, unaware that it was 4:00 or 6:00, Monday or Wednesday. To most of the students, Yaakov Blotnik's mumbling, along with his brown curly beard, scythe nose, and two heel-trailing black cats, made of him an object of wonder, a foreigner, a relic, towards whom they were alternately fearful and disrespectful. To Ozzy, the mumbling had always seemed a monotonous, curious prayer. What made it curious was that old Blotnik had been mumbling so steadily for so many years. Ozzy suspected he had memorized the prayers and forgotten all about God. "It's now free discussion time," Rabbi Binder said. "Feel free to talk about any Jewish matter at all, religion, family, politics, sports." There was silence. It was a gusty, clouded November afternoon, and it did not seem as though there ever was or could be a thing called baseball. So nobody this week said a word about that hero from the past, Hank Greenberg. And the soul-battering Ozzy Friedman had just received from Rabbi Binder had imposed its limitation. When it was Ozzy's turn to read aloud from the Hebrew book, the rabbi had asked him petulantly why he didn't read more rapidly. He was showing no progress. Ozzy said that he could read faster, but if he did, he was sure not to understand what he was reading. Nevertheless, at the rabbi's repeated suggestion, Ozzie tried and showed a great talent. But in the midst of a long passage, he stopped short and said he didn't understand a word he was reading. Consequently, when free discussion time rolled around and none of the students felt too free, the rabbi's invitation was answered only by the mumbling of feeble old Blotnick. There was a small grumble from the third row. The rabbi requested that Ozzie rise and give the rest of the class the advantage of his thought. Rabbi Binder advanced a seat towards Ozzie and poised himself on the edge of his desk. It was Itzi's desk, and the rabbi's frame was only a dagger's length away from his face. "Stand up again, Oscar," Rabbi Binder said calmly, "and try to assemble your thoughts." Ozzie stood up. All his classmates turned in their seats and watched as he gave an unconvincing scratch to his forehead. "I can't assemble any," he announced and plunked himself down. "Stand up," Rabbi Binder advanced from Itzi's desk to the one directly in front of Ozzie. When the rabbinical back was turned, Itzi gave it five fingers off the tip of his nose. Rabbi Binder was too absorbed in squelching Ozzie's nonsense once and for all to bother with titters. "Stand up, Oscar. What's your question about?" Trapped, Ozzie blurted the first thing that came to him. "Why can't he make anything he wants to make?" As Rabbi Binder prepared an answer, a final answer, Itzi, 10 feet behind him, raised one finger on his left hand, gestured it meaningfully toward the rabbi's back, and brought the house down. Binder twisted quickly to see what had happened, and in the midst of the commotion, Ozzie shouted into the rabbi's back what he couldn't have shouted to his face. It was a loud, toneless sound that had the timbre of something stored inside for about 6 days. "You don't know! You don't know anything about God!" The rabbi spun back towards Ozzie. "What? You don't know! Apologize, Oscar! Apologize! You don't..." Rabbi Binder's hand flicked out at Ozzie's cheek. Perhaps it had only been meant to clamp the boy's mouth shut, but Ozzie ducked, and the palm caught him squarely on the nose. The blood came in a short red spurt onto Ozzie's shirt front. The next moment was all confusion. Ozzie screamed, "You bastard! You bastard!" and broke from the classroom door. Rabbi Binder lurched a step backwards, as though his own blood had started flowing violently in the opposite direction. Then he gave a clumsy lurch and bolted out the door after Ozzie. The class followed after the rabbi's huge blue-suited back, and before old Blotnick could turn from his window, the room was empty, and everyone was headed full speed up the 3 flights leading to the roof. If one should compare the light of day to the light of man, sunrise to birth, sunset, the dropping down over the edge to death, then, as Ozzie Friedman wiggled through the trap door of the synagogue roof, his feet kicking backwards, Bronco style, at Rabbi Binder's outstretched arms, at that moment, the day was 50 years old. As a rule, 50 or 55 reflects accurately the age of late afternoons in November, for it is in that month, during those hours, that one's awareness of light seems no longer a matter of seeing, but of hearing. In fact, as Ozzie locked shut the trap door in the rabbi's face, the sharp click of the bolt in the lock might momentarily have been mistaken for the sound of the heavier gray that had just throbbed through the sky. With all his weight, Ozzie kneeled on the locked door. Any instant, he was certain that Rabbi Binder's shoulder would fling it open, splintering the wood into shrapnel and catapulting his body into the sky. But the door did not move, and below him he heard only the rumble of feet, first loud, then dim, like thunder rolling away. A question shot through his brain. Can this be me? For a 13-year-old who had just labeled his religious leader a bastard twice, it was not an improper question. Is it me? Is it me? It's the question a thief must ask himself the night he jimmies open his first window. And it's said to be the question with which bridegrooms quiz themselves before the altar. "Oscar! Oscar Friedman!" A voice rose from the center of the crowd outside the synagogue. A voice that, could it have been seen, would have looked like the writing on a scroll. "Oscar Friedman, get down from that roof immediately!" Rabbi Binder was pointing one arm stiffly up at him. At the end of that arm, one finger aimed menacingly. It was the attitude of a dictator, but one, the eyes confessed all, whose personal valet had spit neatly in his face. Ozzie didn't answer. Only for a blink's length did he look towards Rabbi Binder. Instead, his eyes began to fit together the world beneath him, to sort out people from places, friends from enemies, participants from spectators. In the little jagged starlight clusters, his friends stood around Rabbi Binder, who was still pointing. The topmost point on the star, compounded not of angels, but of five adolescent boys, was Itzi. What a world it was, with those stars below, Rabbi Binder below, Ozzie, who a moment earlier hadn't been able to control his own body, started to feel the meaning of the word control. He felt peace, and he felt power. Oscar Friedman, I'll give you three to come down. Few dictators give their subjects three to do anything, but as always, Rabbi Binder only looked dictatorial. Are you ready, Oscar? Ozzie nodded his head yes, although he had no intention of the world of coming down, even if Rabbi Binder should give him a million. When the engines, all four of them, arrived, the fire engines, Rabbi Binder had four times given Oscar the count of three. The big hook and ladder truck swung around the corner, and one of the firemen leaped from it, plunging headlong toward the yellow fire hydrant in front of the synagogue. With a huge wrench, he began to unscrew the top nozzle. Rabbi Binder raced over to him and pulled at his shoulder. There's no fire. The fireman mumbled something over his shoulder and heatedly continued working at the nozzle. But there's no fire! There's no fire! Binder shouted. When the fireman mumbled again, the rabbi grasped his face with both his hands and pointed it up at the roof. To Ozzie, it looked as though Rabbi Binder was trying to tug the fireman's head out of his body, like a cork from a bottle. He had to giggle at the picture they made. It was a family portrait. Rabbi in black skull cap, fireman in red fire hat, and a little yellow hydrant squatting beside like a kid brother, bareheaded. From the edge of the roof, Ozzie waved at the portrait, a one-handed, flapping, mocking wave. In doing it, his right foot slipped from under him. Rabbi Binder covered his eyes with his hands. Firemen work fast. Ozzie had even regained his balance. A big, round, yellow net was being held on the synagogue lawn. The firemen who held the net looked up at Ozzie with stern, feelingless faces. One of the firemen turned his head toward Rabbi Binder. What, is this kid nuts or something? Is he going to jump or what? Yes, said Rabbi Binder. Yes, I think so. He's been threatening to... Threatening? Why, the reason he was up on the roof, Ozzie remembered, was to get away. He hadn't even thought about jumping. He had just had to run to get away, and the truth was that he hadn't really headed for the roof as much as he had been chased there. The fireman looked up at Ozzie. What is it with you, kid? You gonna jump or what? Look, kid, if you're gonna jump, jump. And if you're not gonna jump, don't jump. But don't waste our time, will you? Ozzie looked at the fireman and then at Rabbi Binder. He wanted to see Rabbi Binder cover his eyes one more time. I'm gonna jump! And then he scampered around the edge of the roof to the corner where there was no net below. And he flapped his arms at his side, switching at the air and smacking his palms to his trousers on the downbeat. He began screaming like some kind of engine, wee, wee, and leaning way out on the edge with the upper half of his body. The fireman whipped around to cover the ground with the net. Rabbi Binder mumbled a few words to somebody and covered his eyes. Everything happened quickly, jerkily, as in a silent movie. Rabbi Binder peeked through his fingers, checked the sidewalk and the net, empty. But there was Ozzie, racing to the other corner. The firemen raced with him, but were unable to keep up. Whenever Ozzie wanted to, he might jump and splatter himself on the sidewalk. And by the time the firemen scooted to the spot, all they could do with their net would be to cover the mess. Hey, kid, The fireman yelled, "What the hell is this, a game or something?" But he was now off to the other corner, flapping his wings fiercely. Rabbi Binder couldn't take it any longer. The fire engines from nowhere, the screaming suicidal boy, the net. Rabbi Binder fell to his knees, exhausted, and with his hands curled together in front of his chest like a little dome, he pleaded, "Oscar, stop it! Oscar, don't jump, Oscar! Please, come down! Please don't jump!" And further back in the crowd, a single voice, a single young voice, shouted a lone word to the boy on the roof, "Jump!" It was Itzy. Ozzy momentarily stopped flapping. "Go ahead, Oz, jump!" Still on his knees, his hands curled, Rabbi Binder twisted his body around. He looked at Itzy, and then agonizingly back to Ozzy. "Oscar, don't jump! Please, don't jump!" "Jump!" This time it wasn't Itzy, but another point of the star. By the time Mrs. Friedman arrived to keep her 4:30 appointment with Rabbi Binder, the whole little upside-down heaven was shouting and pleading for Ozzy to jump. And Rabbi Binder no longer was pleading with him not to jump, but was crying into the dome of his hands. Understandably, Mrs. Friedman couldn't figure out what her son was doing on the roof. So she asked, "Ozzy, my Ozzy, what are you doing? My Ozzy, what is it?" Ozzy stopped weeing and slowed his arms down to a cruising flap. He stood against the low, clouded, darkening sky. Light clicked down softly now, as on a small gear, flapping softly and gazing at the small bundle of a woman who was his mother. "What are you doing, Ozzy?" She turned toward the kneeling Rabbi Binder and rushed so close that only a paper thickness of dust lay between her stomach and his shoulders. "What is my baby doing?" Rabbi Binder gaped up at her, but he was mute. All that moved was the dome of his hands. It shook back and forth like a weak pulse. "Rabbi, get him down. He'll kill himself. Get him down, my only baby." "I can't," Rabbi Binder said. "I can't." "It's them. Listen to the boys. He's doing it for them. He won't listen to me. It's them."
"For them?"
"Yes."
"Why for them?"
"Well, they want him to..." Mrs. Friedman raised her two arms upward as though she were conducting the sky. "For them he's doing it?" And then in a gesture older than pyramids, older than prophets and floods, her arms came slapping down to her sides. "A martyr I have, look!" "Oscar," Rabbi Binder groaned, "come down, please." Somehow when you're on a roof, the darker it gets, the less you can hear. All Ozzy knew was that two groups wanted two new things. His friends were spirited and musical about what they wanted for him to jump. His mother and the rabbi were even-toned, chanting about what they didn't want. The rabbi's voice was without tears now, and so was his mother's. The big net stared up at Ozzy like a sightless eye. The big clouded sky pushed down. From beneath it looked like a gray corrugated board. Suddenly, looking up into that unsympathetic sky, Ozzy realized all the strangeness of these people, his friends, what they were asking. They wanted him to jump, to kill himself. They were singing about it now, to make them all happy. And there was an even greater strangeness. Rabbi Binder was on his knees, trembling. If there was a question to be asked now, it was not, "Is it me?" but, "Is it us? Is it us?" Ozzy, in a curiously high voice, like one who wasn't prepared for his speech, said, "Mama?"
"Yes, Oscar."
"Mama, get down on your knees like Rabbi Binder."
"Oscar, get down on your knees or I'll jump."
Ozzy heard a whimper, then a quick rustling, and when he looked down where his mother had stood, he saw the top of a head, and beneath that, a circle of dress. She was kneeling beside Rabbi Binder. He spoke again.
"Everybody kneel!"
There was the sound of everybody kneeling. Ozzy looked around. With one hand, he pointed towards the synagogue entrance.
"Make him kneel!"
There was a noise, not of kneeling, but of body and cloth stretching. Ozzy could hear Rabbi Binder saying in a gruff whisper, "Or he'll kill himself." And when next he looked, there was Yakov Blotnik off the doorknob, and for the first time in his life, was on his knees in the Gentile posture of prayer. As for the fireman, it's not as difficult as one might imagine to hold a net taut while you're kneeling. Ozzie looked around again, and then he called to Rabbi Binder.
Rabbi?
Yes, Oscar.
Rabbi Binder, do you believe in God?
Yes.
Do you believe God can do anything?
Ozzie leaned his head out into the darkness.
Anything? Oscar, I think, do you believe God can do anything?
There was a second's hesitation. Then,
God can do anything.
Tell me you believe God can make a child without intercourse.
He can.
Tell me!
God can make a child without intercourse.
Mama, you tell me.
God can make a child without intercourse, his mother said.
Make him tell me.
There was no doubt who him was. In a few moments, Ozzie heard an old comical voice say something to the increasing darkness about God. Next, Ozzie made everybody say it. And then he made them all say that they believed in Jesus Christ, first one at a time and then all together. When the catechizing was through, it was the beginning of evening. From the street, it sounded as if the boy on the roof might have sighed.
Ozzie, a woman's voice dared to speak, you'll come down now?
There was no answer, but the woman waited. And when a voice finally did speak, it was thin and crying and exhausted, as that of an old man who had just finished pulling the bells.
Mama, don't you see? You shouldn't hit me.
He shouldn't hit me.
You shouldn't hit anybody about God, Mama. You should never hit anybody about God.
Ozzie, please come down now.
Promise me. Promise me you'll never hit anybody about God.
He had asked only his mother, but for some reason, everyone kneeling in the street promised he would never hit anybody about God. Once again, there was silence.
I can come down now, Mama, the boy on the roof finally said.
He turned his head both ways as though checking the traffic lights.
Now I can come down.
And he did, right into the center of the yellow net that glowed in the evening's edge like an overgrown halo. That was The Conversion of the Jews by Phillip Roth. That's all for tonight. Thank you for watching.